Okay, we are going to move into chapter 12 of the book of Acts today. Let me recap a little bit of what we've learned from the last time. One thing that we picked up on that is that we're going to remember that a person could be in the family of believers, even have been baptized, attending church, tithing, serving in different areas of the ministry, and one could possibly still not be actually saved, right? That could really happen because if that person's faith is in the doing the religion, if your faith is in the religion and your works, then it is misplaced faith. And that's not saving faith. Our faith must be in the Savior who died for us. My faith is completely in Him, not in my works whatsoever, not at all. So, many out there in the church today, their faith really is in the fact that they're in church and they've done these things. And, oh yeah, he's great. Yeah, he died on the cross for me. But their faith is, if they were knocking on heaven's door, right? We're not supposed to have to do that anyway. We're either already, right? But if we were out there knocking and we were asked, why should I let you in? The first thing these people would do is start saying the things they've done, right? Well, you're a cheat in here because I've done this, and the other thing. And it's like, not the right answer. The right answer is because Jesus died for me. He paid my price. My faith is in him. Oh, yeah, well, what are you doing out there? Come in here, right? But we're not going to be knocked on heaven's door, right? We're going to be the ones that are already in there. From here to there, we're with him, right? So, but a person could also be in the family of believers, even through faith, a saved individual, been baptized, they're attending church, they're tithing, they're serving in different ministry areas, and still could have something like racial or ethnic or cultural economic prejudices that hinder them from actually doing his work. Happens all the time too, right? So we're not guaranteed that just because we got saved, all of a sudden our prejudices are gone. It's something that we have to work on. And these early Jewish Christians, demonstrated that for us. They were not going out and spreading the word like they were supposed to. They were only talking to other Jews. They weren't going to the Gentiles at all. And see, that's an example. And the challenge in all of that was to us, what's my prejudice? What do I have that keeps me from talking to anybody that the Lord would say, talk to this guy, talk to that guy? They don't look like someone we ought to be talking to. Right? They don't go to church. They're not good church people. We should just avoid them. Right? No. We'll never spread the gospel if that was our way of doing it. Right? Okay, so anyway, remember that regarding Barnabas, the Holy Spirit through the pen of Luke in this book said he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith. And our other challenge in that chapter was, could that be said about you? Would people say that about you? Would the Lord say that about you? That's more important. It's more important what he would say about you than what people say. So that's something that we wonder about. So today, anyway, we're going to hear a little bit about Herod Antipas and Herod Antipas the First, and how he begins to wreak havoc on the church, and then his death, and then Peter's deliverance from death row. We're going to get into that. And we're going to fly through all of chapter 12 today. There's not a good place to divide chapter 12. I looked at it. I tried to make this two weeks right now. There's no place to stop. It's just that it's not as awkward. Anywhere I tried to think I would stop there. So we're going to go all through chapter 12 today. So fasten your seatbelts. Make sure your helmet's tied in. First four verses. I'll get back to it. I touched the wrong thing here. So jump back to chapter 2. Just a second. chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. All right, so James, the brother of John, not the first Christian martyr, but the first one we're hearing about that was of the 12. Okay, this is not the James that was the brother of Jesus. This is the sons of Zebedee, the brother of John, the apostle Jesus loved, right? This is his brother. One of the sons of thunder. And you can also remember, if you've read through the Gospels, they were the two that got their mom to come and ask Jesus if they could each sit on thrones on the sides of him when they got to go into the kingdom, right? And the mom said, "Can my son sit on these thrones?" You know, she had to be told that it doesn't work that way. It's not that anyway. That assignment is not for me to give at this time. So, Peter, James, and John were the three inner circle with Jesus. So it's that James. It's this one, Peter, James, and John, that they're always there traveling with Jesus close by everywhere they went. So, why would killing a fellow Jew who just happened to be a follower of Jesus please the Jews, you might ask? Why would that please them? Are they sick? Right? It's sick. It'd be like us saying, you know, well, someone who belongs to, it would be to us one of the cults, right, that says they're part of Christendom, but has departed from the basic tenets of the gospel. You know, they're outside actual Christianity, but they're claiming to be Christians, like, right? We don't appreciate that much. But it would be like one of them, someone joining one of them, and so because of that, we want to have a put to death. And we'd be gleeful over someone dying. I don't want people in the cults to die. You know, I want them to come to see the light. I hope that they'll get it straight, right? I don't want to see them die. So what's wrong with these people? It pleased the Jews to have James beheaded. You know, that's wrong. There's something wrong with those people. There's a hatred there that goes beyond normal. I've said this before, that this hatred that was in there, just like the hatred of the Jews later on in our history, is something that goes beyond normal and spiritual. It's a spiritual hatred. It's backed by demonic activity. It's that kind of hatred. That's just not normal. And this particular Herod we're talking about here was Agrippa the First. He was the grandson of Herod the Great, the one that was called Herod the Great, right? A Jewish princess named Miriam, who was a descendant of the Maccabees. If you knew the history at all, you know the Maccabean revolt that happened and everything. She was a descendant of them, and she was a princess of royalty among the Jews, of the Hebrew people. But she married Herod the Great, and they had a kid. And so anyway, this guy here is their grandson. So, he's got half Jewish Hebrew blood, but half Edomite blood, right? Because the Herods were not Jewish. That's why it was a big slap in the face to the Jewish people to appoint one of the Edomites as the king in Judea, right? And that was a big slap in the face to the Jews, but the Romans did that because they were trying to take true power away, but they didn't want anybody in there that the Jews would recognize as could actually be on the throne. Because the throne over the Jews had to be someone out of the tribe of Judah and in the line of David. Right? So Jesus actually fills that. He actually deserves that role. Anyway, this is who this guy is, this Herod that we're talking about here. It's said that he actually tried to fit in with the Jews and was interested in Judaism prior to being made king. And he wanted to be liked by these Jewish people. So, anyway, you can see that in what he did here. That would be why he didn't want to violate the Passover like his grandfather had been taking part in Jesus' crucifixion during the same time with the Passover. So he waited, wasn't going to do something like that during this week, right? So why Peter and not James? I'll get to that in a minute. All right, let's look at verses 5 to 7. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrists. That's pretty cool. Now, this is when I say, why Peter and not James? Why did this happen when James was in there? You might ask, why does the angel show up now when it's Peter? Was he slow? Wasn't he there not quick enough, whatever, it's time to kill James? We don't know. We can't ask questions like that. Because we don't know what the Lord's intent on things is. We don't know why things happen the way they do. We just can't ask questions like that. But, you know, it's natural to think, well, why didn't he save James like he saved Peter like this, right? The church was praying earnestly for Peter. You might ask, well, weren't they praying for James? Well, maybe, you know, they may not have done that. Might have happened so fast they didn't even get a chance to get together. And then immediately after him being executed, now they go into prayer before all of them. Right? So that's possible. We don't know for sure all the details. But if you are in the habit of prayer, it doesn't come out of you automatically. Think of that. If you're in the habit of prayer, it's going to happen automatically. The Nehemiah prayer is a good way to start, I say. That's the one that you just have happening under your breath all the time. You know, you're praying while you're talking to somebody else. You'll be in the middle of a conversation and praying at the same time. That's a good habit to be in, I think. So, shock can paralyze you and keep you from praying till you come to your senses or hear someone else suggest, hey, we should pray. You know, it's a kind of that. So, God chooses to work through prayer. Maybe if the church had prayed earnestly for James, who knows? I don't know, but we can't ask questions like that. This was God's plan. It was God's plan to take James out this time. He allowed it to happen. So it's certain that God does respond to his people praying. He gave Hezekiah 15 more years when he prayed earnestly. Many accounts in Scripture are the Lord changing things because his people pray. So it's for sure here that the difference between James and Peter in Scripture is that the church was praying earnestly for him. So, is that why he's released with an angelic miracle? I don't know. I just don't really know for sure. But, would God let his servant die because the others didn't pray enough? I don't think that's really God's servant. Does he let another one of his servants suffer or die because a different servant isn't praying hard enough? Boy, if it worked like that, I'd be doing it in everybody. Pray all the time. Pray for everybody. Maybe we should do that. But we should be about prayer. I like how it says that the angel smacked Peter and said, wait up. That's pretty cool. That's the way I read it. He hit him on the side, right? Hey, smack. Wait up. Hey, who are you? Oh, Gabriel. Cool. Good to see you again. Anyway, the chains just fell off. The guards didn't see it happening. They didn't see a thing. That's the kind of miracle I like to see. That's really cool stuff. All right, let's look at verses 8 to 9. Then the angel said to him, put on your clothes and sandals. And Peter did so. Wrap your cloak around you and follow me. The angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison. But he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. Well, yeah. You know, remember, he saw the vision of the sheep being let down from heaven with all the animals in it and said, you know, remember the Don't call what I've made clean, clean, or unclean. Anyway, he is a type of humanity, and Peter is a type of humanity in this story. He kind of represents all of us in this story. We should be able to see ourselves in Peter. He represents all of humanity. So if you think about it, there he is chained up because we are in bondage to our sin, right? And to our old ways. He was doomed to die just as we are because of sin without a Savior. He was being guarded by these guards as we are by the devil's minions. You don't believe it? Well, let's think about it and watch how he works. If they work around him, we're being guarded in prison by them. Well, we've been set free because we're saved. We're Christians. But prior to that, the devil doesn't want to have anybody get saved. He doesn't want to lose them. So anyway, no work of our own to gain this freedom. Jesus paid it all. We must say yes, Lord, when he calls us to repentance and believe in him. So anyway, God does all the work, and if we follow his call, we just realize one day that he has set us free. That was the verse 10 and 11. They passed the first and second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself, and they went through it. When they had walked the length of one street, suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I know without a doubt that the Lord sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were anticipating." So, I said, "Oh, well, now I know, right? Now I know." Anyway, he had thought he was out of vision before, kind of like the previous one. He was used to that. Also noteworthy here is that Peter recognized that his fellow countrymen, the former brothers, the Jews, were out to get him. He did recognize that. He knows that the Jews were out to get him, and they wanted to see him today. So, he knows that, and should be guarded a little bit around him. All right, verses 12 to 14. When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, "Peter's at the door." So she left him out there. Poor Peter's like, "I just saw an angel open doors, and I can't get Rhoda to open the door for me." Right? This is something. I'm stuck standing in the street in front of Mark's house, and these people could come by and see me out here. He's probably going like this, "Rhoda, let me in." Anyway, so why didn't Rhoda open the door? Well, let's find out. 15 to 17 now. "You're out of your mind," they told her. When she kept insisting that it was so, they said, "It must be his angel." But Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. "Tell James and the brothers about this," he said, and left them. Then he left for another place. So it's funny how these people have been praying for his release, but they don't believe it's him at the door. Is that an example of us as people as well? Do we pray for things but not really expect the Lord to ever do it? I think we're called to be in prayer but with expectancy. Jesus insisted, in fact, that when we pray, we believe that we will receive what we ask for. So we have to pray expectantly. Peter motioned for them to quiet down so the guards wouldn't hear the commotion and find him again. When Peter said to go tell James, didn't he know that James had been killed? Oh, different James. Right? So in case you were wondering and tripped over that when you're reading the text, when he says go tell James and the brothers, now he's talking about James, the brother of Jesus. See, now that James the brother had become a believer as well. And he was, by tradition, tells us in him that he was rabbinically trained. He marries a little boy that was going to be a rabbi, right? And so he was already in training and understood how to work with people. And so when he becomes a believer, he's right in there leading the church. And he had become the leader of the church in Jerusalem. So the group of Christians that were still in Jerusalem are being led by James, the brother of Jesus, also the James that wrote the book of James. Right? So we know this about us. This is the one he said, go tell him and the brothers. And he's separating him and the brothers because James wasn't one of the 12. He wasn't a disciple of Jesus. He was a little brother. He didn't believe in the life of the resurrection. So that's why there's a difference. So the brothers are there, and James. And the brothers is referring to the other apostles that are around there still. So, yeah, he knew this was James, the son of Zebedee. He knew that James, the son of Zebedee, had been killed, and he was speaking to this other James. So, all right, now let's look at verses 18 and 19. In the morning, there was no small commotion among the soldiers as to what had become of Peter. After Herod had a thorough search made for him and did not find him, he cross-examined the guards and ordered that they be executed. Then Herod went from Judea to Caesarea and stayed there for a while. Okay, so in the old King James way, and since it was translated that way a long time ago, we still get that even in our modern English translations. We still get some phrasing out of it. There was no small commotion. It was a big commotion. That's just another way to say it. This was a big commotion. No small commotion. We don't talk like that now, but we'd say, like, this was a big old commotion. It seems harsh to me to execute these guards, but that was the penalty in the Roman law. They lose a prisoner like that, they're supposed to be executed. So nobody was going to believe that these guards all stayed awake and did their job, but their prisoner just vanished before their eyes. Nobody's going to believe that. So Herod decided to get out of town for a while, likely to seem unconcerned rather than seem defeated. See, he's thinking about this politically. This is a defeat. So, I'd like to follow me home to Caesarea, the country house, for a while, hang out there. So. All right, verses 20 to 22. Now, he had been quarreling with the people of Tyre and Sidon. They now joined together and saw an audience with him, having secured the support of Blastus, a trusted personal servant of the king. They asked for peace, because they depend on the king's country for their food supply. On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robes, sat on his throne and delivered a public address to the people. They shouted, "This is the voice of a god, not a man." Right? You almost like throw up a little bit in your mouth when you say that, right? If it doesn't, it does that to me. I can't stand it. Hear that. But anyway, these people are trying to butter up Herod so that they wouldn't starve back in their own country. So, they're saying something that just feeds his already massive ego. It flattered him with some fake worship and praise. They called him a god, which is how the people throughout the Roman Empire thought of their rulers if they were in the pantheism and ruler worship. Some of them back in Rome were. The historian Flavius Josephus wrote a book called The Antiquity of the Jews, and in that he said that this Herod arrived to give an audience to the people of Tyre and Sidon, and he came in wearing a bright, shiny silver robe that looked like it was glowing. This was written in Josephus' writing. This is the voice of a god, not a man. So, verses 23 to 25. Now, immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down. He was eaten by worms and died. But the word of God continued to increase and spread. When Barnabas and Saul had finished their mission, they returned from Jerusalem, taking with them John, also called Mark. The historians said that Herod began suffering intense pain and died within a couple of days. They gave the details to this event. This would be how the world saw it, but the Holy Spirit described it as an angel from the Lord struck him, and he was eaten by worms and died. So we know there were worms involved in an angel because the Lord said so in his word. Herod allowed men to make him a god, and he received worship as such, which was a test of whether this half-Edomite, half-Jew leader, whether he would turn to God or turn away completely, and he failed the test. So I believe that if at this point, it's just my own opinion, if at that point Herod would have stopped them and said, I'm just a man, don't worship me, the Lord may have begun to stir in him to seek God and possibly turn to Jesus as Christ. There were other leaders that did, so it was possible, but he didn't do that. The other way. Herod chose the path of self-actualization and glorification, to become greater than others and elevate himself, to be served and not to serve, which was the opposite of Jesus. We are called to be servants. We're called to be servants of all and of God most of all, and not to be served by all and lorded over God. Christ-like way was a life of other-centered service, more concerned with others' needs than your own. That was what Jesus was like. And if we're going to be like Jesus, that's the kind of thing we're going to follow. When people say, I want to be a little more like Jesus, that's not a religious statement. That's a personal, that's because he was kind of irreligious, really. Read through the Gospels. The really religious people didn't like him. Said that he was breaking their rules and all that. But we're to be like him, right? We're called to be like Jesus. There are times in life where it might happen where you start getting praise from other people. If someone compliments your work, take it and say thank you. That's gratitude. That's what it is. Say thank you for that. That's okay. But when it starts to get to where you feel like you're a king, you're a god, right? That must be really hard for people who really get celebrity status. Celebrities start feeling a little bit like they're being worshipped. And they many times are. People are basically worshiping these other people. If you get to know things about them, you're like, why in the world would you worship that person? Do you not know if you really knew what they were about? But on that other side of it, we're not to take that. Just might get struck by a smack by an angel and eaten by worms, right? I don't want that to happen. So your message today to you is don't be eaten by worms, right? And, don't be all ate up with, self-actualization and grandizing self and putting yourself up higher than other people. Don't get wrapped into that. Don't fall for things like that. And also, I think another message in this verse today would be that when we pray, expect God to work and do what it is we ask. Don't say, we didn't pray, but it can't be. It didn't really happen because that can't really happen. We prayed for it, right? So I think that's a really good message here. Verse 25 marks the beginning of the second half of this book of Acts. That's good. Verse 25 right there, it marks that beginning. So from here on, there's a change that happens. And when we get into chapter 13 next time, we'll see more of that happening. So we're going to follow the journeys of Paul mostly, and we won't hear that much about Peter. If you're wondering, well, what happened to Peter after this, where did he go? Tradition has it that he started migrating towards the north and ministering up there. And we know that's a good hunch. It's a good idea because we know there were a lot of Jewish people up in the area of Babylon. So, remember, whenever all the Jews were in captivity up in Babylon, they didn't because they were free up there. They'd been set free, and then maybe they already had businesses and had started their family there and friends and all that stuff. All right, well, you guys go down there. We'll send some money with you to help support the rebuilding of the temple and all that, but we're going to stay up here. So there were a lot of Jews up in that area. Someone needed to go and talk to them to tell them their Messiah has come. Right? And the apostle to the Jews, being Peter, being at least one of them, that would be a likely thing. So it's probably what happened with Peter after that. But we're going to hear a whole lot about what happened to Paul. And remember, this book was written as trial documents for Paul's defense later on. The book of Acts and the Gospel of Luke were these documents written on behalf of Paul by Luke for his support when he was appealing to go to Caesar. So these were written for that purpose. Holy Spirit saw fit to put them in two canon scriptures. So we're grateful for it. It tells us how the church got started and all these things we learn by these examples. And the bad examples, too. Right? So let's close there today. We made it through the whole chapter. I told you to put your seatbelt on. It didn't take that long, did it? We'll be into chapter 13 next time. Let's close the prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for speaking to us through it as we go through here and teaching us things as we just take in your word, teaching us what you would have us to learn. And Lord, we ask that you would bring it to mind as we go about our week and that you would have us to remember the things in this as we go on and encourage us in spirit, in our hearts, to read more, to get in there and study more. And all these things we pray for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.